right, today on our show,
Sundance,
He-Man,
Star Wars,
Darkseid,
all this and so much more in a brand new Fat Man on Batman. Welcome to Fat Man on Batman, where we robot. I'm Kevin Smith.
Mark Bernard.
You didn't even join me in a fucking robot, dude. Nah, you left me hanging and shit. I was a lone droid. I was like, so when R2-D2 and C-3PO separated in the desert, or to be more current for today's kids, I felt like BB-8.
Nice. I was going Dr. Theopolis.
Oh, is that what you were doing?
Yeah.
Just hanging on my chest and chilling. Shit. And I was Twickying. Iggy Biggie. I just got back from the Sundance Film Festival, folks.
Yeah, was it fun?
It was amazing.
Was it cold?
It was fucking freezing. I wore pants. That's how cold it was.
Holy shit.
22 years I've been going to the Sundance Film Festival since 1994, a little picture called Clerks, which I never stopped talking about. We went back this year with a different movie set in a convenience store called Yoga Hosers. 10th movie, 10th time I've been to Sundance in 22 years, fourth time as a director with a film. Two other times I was a producer, one time I was a judge, two other times I was just there fucking around.
Yeah, as you do.
As you do with Sundance. But it was a fucking blast, man. My kid is one of those kids in the movie. The other one is Harley Quinn Smith, the other one's Lily Rose Depp. They're the two stars. They were in Tusk in one scene, spun it off into a whole fucking movie. We had three midnight screenings while I was there, and they have one more, I think, today in Salt Lake City.
Anybody still there?
No, everybody from the cast and crew have gone home. I was the last holdout. I held on because there was a screening, was it yesterday? The day before, at the Egyptian Theater in Park City. And that's where we sold Clerks. So it was like pretty historic and wonderful and stuff like that. So I wanted to be there for that screening. But everyone else, like we had Harley, Lily, Justin Long, Natasha Lyonne, Tyler Posey, Austin Butler, Ralph Garman, who else went, man? Sashir Zamata showed up. She's in the movie. Not like she showed up and we're like, what the fuck are you doing here? Sashir from SNL is in the movie, but she was back east, trapped in the blizzard. And
Blizzard.
And she showed up, like, for the screening. All of a sudden, as everyone in the cast came up, she was standing in front. I was like, is she here? So that was really sweet. And I hope I'm not missing everybody. I think I got everybody. Myself, Jason Mewes, my wife, Jen, who's a producer, and she was in the movie. Jason's wife, Jordan, was there as well. Really fucking awesome, man. Three great screenings that I went to. It was lovely watching the kid. Mm-hmm. Find her tribe, like that was really special and stuff. The reviews have not been kind, but you know, it's a fucked up movie. Like I knew that, so I'm not even like, why are they good? I get it. This is the artiest art film I've ever made in my life. If you think fucking Tusk was an art film, Jesus Christ, this is a pop art film though. It's a movie for a very specific audience. 12-year-old girls is my core demographic. That's what I made the movie for. So I've looked at, like, you know, people's reaction. I'm like, what the fuck is he on? Well, we all know. But it's not that. It's like I never really had an experimental filmmaking period in my career. I made Clerks, and that wasn't experimental. That was me trying to go, like, this is a big boy movie. So, you know, late in life or midlife now, I'm 45, been doing this 22 years, quit directing at one point after Red State, came back to do Tusk. When I came back, I said, I'm only going to make the movies that I want to make. Obviously, the movies I want to make, nobody wants to see right now. But that is fine. Like, I got to go through my process and stuff. So we got one more movie left. And again, like, I love these movies so much, dude. Like, everyone else is baffled by them. Baffled to, like, we fucking hate them. But, like, these movies are my heart. It's so weird to watch people react to them that way. But I get it. They're fucking weird. So we did Tusk. Now Yoga Hosers, man, which is as tonally different from Tusk as Tusk was from everything else I've done. And so tonally different that people are like, your tone fucking deaf. The reviews, again, I could show you a bleeding wreck of it stuff. It's fucked up. People really don't like the movie. There's a handful. There's one, like, we got, the first one we got, I think, was from Vulture. That was pretty good. And I put up a tweet, like, I feel like Andy Potts in Ghostbusters. We got one! But some cats get, like, real irate and stuff. Like, I understand y'all like the movie, but they're like, why is he fucking doing this? It's like, Why'd I do Clerks? Why'd I do anything I do? Because that's what I got to do.
I want to make a thing. I want to put a thing in the world.
Oh, my God, man. And sometimes you like that thing, and sometimes that thing is laid on your leg, and you're like, ew, get it off me and shit. And I put it back in my pants. That's what Yoga Hosers is, a metaphor for that film. So it was wonderful, dude. Like, honestly, even with the bad reviews and shit, like, I knew it going in. This movie is not for everyone. And I'm not even saying they didn't understand it. Like, people can go, oh, I understand. I just fucking hate it. It is so... It's a very thin bridge. Like my friend Malcolm, I felt, reviewed it best. He goes, if you're ready for that movie, that's the greatest fucking movie you will see all week. Totally. If you're not prepared for that movie and have no interest in that type of film, it is like a wet fart in the room that nobody wants to fucking inhale. That's art, kids. So that it was a blast, dude. Like watching the kid 22 years after I started my career there, started her career there, lovely press on the girls. That's the thing. Even the reviews that are like, fuck him, he's lost his mind, which I can't argue with. They point out that the girls are good. Like, nobody's been like, and the girls fucking suck. They're all like, Cass is great. He's the problem and stuff. So that's fine. I can take that. I've been doing this for so long. It's like, I could take the slings and arrows. I was just glad they didn't go after the girls or the cast, particularly the girls. They're right. So young and shit. But even the worst reviews seem to agree, like, look, these girls are talented and stuff. Yeah. He's the problem.
The press coming out of it, like, I just saw the wall of just like, hey, look, it's this photo suite, it's that photo suite, it's this gallery, it's whatever. And the press seemed to love the girls.
They do, which is, that honestly, dude, like, if I'd woken up and the reviews were like, what the fuck is he thinking? These kids are idiots. That would have been, then I would have been affected. I would have been crestfallen. But, you know, talent outs. Like, those girls are talented. That whole cast is talented. They've just been made to do stupid fucking things by a guy who's going through a sort of midlife crisis. Like, you know, I told my wife, I was like, if this is my midlife crisis, I don't fuck around, I don't get a fast car, but I make weird Canadian movies. Are you all right with that? She's like, go ahead, fuck around. Go ahead, it's totally fine. So next one is Moose Jaws, which we start. A lot of people are like, you can't possibly keep going. Yes, I can. We're going to make Moose Jaws, which is very simply just Jaws with a moose instead of a shark. We start in April, right after my Flash episode. So I go up to direct an episode of the Flash in March, unless I get a call from Kreisberg this week going, dude, I saw those reviews. Like, yeah, please stay home and shit. Enjoy the show. Make videos where you cry watching the show. Do not come direct and
stuff. We are not going to have the Atom crawling up Flash's ass.
That was my big move, bitch. Now I know it. Fuck. Sorry.
Listen, Grant, here's what's going to happen here.
Greg Berlanti is fucking calling CW right now going, don't even let him on the plane. His ideas are fucking terrible.
No fly list.
So I'm going to head up, hopefully, unless they take that gig away. I was sitting up there going, these reviews are so bad. Maybe they will take my Flash gig away. If I go up and do Flash in March, which they haven't said no, so I guess I might still get the pity gig, which is awesome. Hey. I'll take it, man. I'm the king of the pity, fuck, so pity gig's good for me.
The pity handy.
Oh, my
Everybody
God.
Everybody wins with a pity handy.
Pity handy. Pity, look at me while I do it, and please don't scoff. Like, that's where I come from.
Stop laughing.
That's why I can survive Yoga Hosers Reviews, because that's where I come from. Just look at it. Please look at it. Don't tell anybody. That's to my wife. So
don't touch it. Don't touch it.
She's like, why would I tell? I would never tell anybody about this. Why did I choose you? As an insight into our marriage. Anyway, fucking blast. Let me share something with you. I've shared it all over the joint, but I'll share it here too, man. Wonderful moment going up there. Give me a single. And get ready to cut back to him for reactions when he cries.
I know.
Because it's powerful.
Working up a tear.
Yeah, fucking start going like this so that when they cut to you, you're rolling a tear.
Punch me in the face!
22 years ago when I went to Sundance, Mark, they have this thing called, you know what, go to the two-shot because then you can move in when it gets intimate. 22 years ago when I went to the Sundance Film Festival, me and Scott Mosier tried to attend the director's brunch. It's something that they put together for all the filmmakers up there and whatnot. It's at Sundance. Sundance Film Festival takes place in Park City. The actual director's brunch takes place in a little town or area called Sundance, which is another mountain altogether up, you know, through the mountains. Beautiful fucking ride. We went 22 years ago, got to a ski lift, saw no brunch, and, you know, we were in our 20s, so like, fuck it, let's go home. And we turned around and went back down to Park City and stuff. So I've never been to it. Here I am 22 years later as they're at the festival as a filmmaker with a film. So I was like, you know what, maybe I'll go. Because they were like, the brunch is Saturday morning. So I was like, okay, all right, I'll try to go. And I got in the car and took a beautiful drive through the mountains and stuff. Got up to the ski lift, could not find the place again. Literally, it was a repeat of 22 years ago, except I was alone. And I was just like, I guess I'll just go and stuff. And then there was a skier. I went, hey, Silent Bob. And I turned, and he skied over. He's like, let's take a selfie. And then a few snowboarders came over, and there was a gaggle of people taking pics and stuff. Because, to be fair, I'm wearing a backwards baseball cap, and I have a long trench coat on. You know, it's, I'm almost cosplaying in the fucking mountains at this point. So they come over, and there's a little, everyone's taking pics. And then one guy goes, you here for the movie thing? And I said, yeah. He goes, oh, it's right up there. And he pointed around a corner. If that dude had been there 22 years ago, I went to this fucking lunch. So it was up around another area that I'd never seen. So I went up there and I found a place and packed with filmmakers. Big room, gorgeous, big spread, lots of great food and stuff. And one bomb and the future of film is over. Or the problem with film is over as well. So a room full of filmmakers, man. And I walked in, I saw people I haven't seen since I was a kid at film festivals. Mm. Some people I know who have films at the festival. They're the two dudes who directed this wonderful film Hawk documentary about my friend Bob Hawk. They were there. I met the woman. So weird. You never get a chance to, like, you know, people say, your movie changed my life or something like that. This is true. I met a filmmaker whose movie changed my life. The woman who directed Fed Up, that documentary that I watched, I was like, I'm going to cut sugar out of my life. So I met her, and I was like, Jesus Christ. Like, your movie literally changed my fucking life. I lost 85 pounds because of you and shit. So then Cooper, who runs the whole thing, he's the head of the festival, he introduces first the programmers to all the directors going like, these are the people in the room that got you into Sundance, and we all give him applause and shit. And then he is like the man of the hour, of course, Robert Redford. And Robert Redford comes in. 22 years I've been going to Sundance, never been in a room with Robert Redford. You know what I'm saying? So strange. Never. But I went up there chiefly that day, I'll be honest, because I was like, I'll get a selfie with Redford. And so he gets up to speak, dude, and he gives like this speech he's probably given a fucking 1,000 times in his life. And it is incredibly moving, man. He's talking about, like, when he was a kid, he loved these weird movies that couldn't find a home. Like, he liked the outsider stuff. And he always felt like, if I get a little success, I'd like to do something about that and stuff. And so, you know, he's like, one day I did get successful. And so we started thinking about, you know, how do we create this community of filmmakers? And as when he said that, when he said community of filmmakers, like, all of a sudden, like, my heart sees, I get a lump in my throat. And I'm like, oh, my God. Like, it's so weird. He's probably told the story a zillion times. But, like, suddenly I'm hearing the story behind my story. You know, so I know my story. It's like, I take Clerks to Sundance, and they bought it, and my career begins, and now I make Yogozers, and they beat me up, but I'll survive, and I got something. You know, it's all this shit going on. It's a long-tail mythology. But I never know or think about the story behind the story. Like, I always begin my Horatio Alger journey begins with me. Really, in my mind, really, it begins kind of with this dude, this actor, who years ago was like, boy, I hope I'm successful enough to do what I want to do. And because he was, I got to do what I wanted to do. You know how many things have to go right in Robert Redford's career in order for Sundance to happen that I could eventually send the film to? And I'm standing there in the back of the room doing bawling. I'm just like, I can't keep up trying to wipe it with my sleeve and stuff because there are no napkins anywhere, even though we're at a buffet and stuff. And so it's all in my beard, and other filmmakers looking at me weird, man. But, like, I got so fucking emotional. I'm like, Jesus Christ, never. There's no one else in the world that's had a bigger impact on my life who I never met before than this man. And it's crazy. And he talked about, like he's like, I love, you know, the Native American community. And in the Native American community, they talk about when you take out something out the earth, you got to put it back. And he's like, and so I felt like I had to give back, and that's why we created this thing and blah blah blah. And it was the community of filmmakers thing, dude. Like, I don't ever really feel like part of any community of filmmakers, man. Like, I feel like I make Kevin Smith movies with one fucking dude in that club and shit, and I'm very lonely. So when he talked about community of filmmakers, I was like, that's fucking dope, man. That was like, that got me right here, cleaved my heart in twain and shit. And so at the end of the day, that was my Sundance highlight. It happened on Saturday. Next night was the movie aired. That was wonderful. Watching the kid fucking, like, get up on a mic and shit. I saw my kid for the first time. Like, I've seen my kid many times, but, like, she was in front of people with a microphone, gave a very long answer to a very short question, handed the microphone to somebody else. They gave an answer, and then she grabbed the mic back to add to it. I was like, that's my child, man. Oh, my gosh, she's a talker. And it was great to see her find her tribe. She's like, I love this. It was so funny, man. At the end of it, she was like, how am I supposed to go back to school? I was like, I know, right? Oh, my God. But this is what you have to look forward to and stuff. So it was wonderful. Whole fucking thing was just a blast. We won an award while we were up there from the Creative Coalition. I know that's going to piss a lot of people off. We're like, this is not an award-winning film. I could literally put on a poster, the award-winning Yoga Hosers, with Sundance laurels and stuff like that. So it was a blast, man. Like, absolutely love it. And then we'll figure out when the movie's coming out and stuff like that. But I it's a comic book movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's the only kind of comic book movie that I'm interested in making or really probably could make. So, you know, I look forward to kind of sharing it. Like, it was great to do it at Sundance and stuff. Mm-hmm. And the audience has embraced it. But, like, the audience for this movie is, like, has yet to see it. It's a midnight movie for an audience that can't get in to see it. You know what I'm saying? Like, this flick is kind of the movie that I wanted to see back when I was a 12-year-old girl. Mm. And I never got a chance to do that. Now I made it as a 45-year-old man and stuff.
Only in America.
Only in America. So we'll talk about that more as shit comes on. But I just had to fucking share that. That just happened this week, and it was such a big deal. Let me throw one more thing about my kid, because I don't just want this to be the fucking My Kid show. I gave my kid a bat last week. Let's throw that picture up. Look at that, dude. Have you ever seen such fucking joy in your life? I wasn't even that happy when that kid holding the bat was born. Like, look at the sheer joy in her face. Bliss, dude.
Tears, and like, I can almost see the snot rolling down. Because
it was
so
there.
Happy.
I got many pictures. I can show you all the snot. That's my daughter, Harley Quinn, obviously, as it's plastered across her fucking chest. Just like her old man, we believe in labeling all of our clothing and
branding.
Stuff. She, what had happened was I directed the Dawn of the Justice League special. Mm-hmm. And the good folks at Warner Brothers, so sweet. I was in my office. And my father-in-law came in, and he was like, knocked on the door. He said, you got a delivery. I said, from what? And he goes, Warner Brothers. And it was a big poster tube. So I was just like, what? Like, what do they? Maybe they sent me a poster for Legends of Tomorrow or something like that. Everybody signed. That was the first thing I went to. Opened up the envelope and stuff. There were two thank you notes from Sue and Blair, the women that run marketing over there, that like beyond marketing, run the fucking studio and stuff. And just like, thanks, like the special was great, and we loved your energy and blah blah blah, and like apparently they were happy with the ratings as well and stuff.
Awesome.
So they were like, to thank you, you know, we've sent you Harley Quinn's bat from Suicide Squad with certificate of authenticity and you know, there's instructions on it, like you can't sell this, you can't kill people with it. Technically we own it if you fuck with it, but it's your gift. It's very fucking sweet, dude. And you know, it's a movie, so I'm sure they had fucking 26 of them, but right. I got one of them and stuff, and it's the detail is fucking insane. It's exquisite. I'd seen it on the set of that Dawn of the Justice League special, but like I got to study the whole fucking thing. I pulled it out of the tube. I was like, holy shit, this is what a cool gift. But if there's anybody who's going to appreciate this, I mean, I put it on two pegs hanging in my office, but like the kid whose room is right below my office, like she lives for this shit. She loves the Suicide Squad trailers, treats it like religion, dude. Like she can't wait for that movie. It's wonderful to see her embrace her namesake and stuff, like in a big, bad way. Because historically growing up, she was never like, I'm Harley Quinn. But now she like, oh, she's wants to, I've read in fucking Hollywood Reporter, remember? She was like, I want to be Harley Quinn. And I was like, in a world where the fucking asshole from Fashionable Male is Batman, you got a chance, kid. Just not now, like 10 years from now or whatever the fuck. So I was like, I'm gonna give her a bat. So I collect my wife and I'm like, let's go downstairs. I want to give Harley something. She's like, what is it? And I'm like, just come with me. You're going to love this. She goes, fucking tell me. And I was like, no, you just come and watch. She's like, why does everything have to be a game? And I was like, just fucking calm, man. Doing something sweet. We went downstairs into the kids' room. It was right before we go to Sundance. So I was like, hey, kiddo, we need to talk to you. And she was like, okay. And she's looking at us like, uh-oh. Are they going to try to talk to me about sex? Like, kiddo? So I was like, well, we leave for Sundance tomorrow. Everything in your life could possibly change. They may love the movie, they may hate the movie and stuff, but like, you're gonna be different when you get back. Like, it's just everything changes. And you won't be a completely different person, but like, who knows what happens from Sundance forward, man. The movie's out there in the world and blah, blah, blah. I said, so you never know what's gonna happen, man. So I figured we would give you a very powerful totem with which to face the future. I was like, you know what a totem is? And she's like, no. And I was like, totem, man. Like, it's an instrument that has a lot of power to it, wards off evil and stuff, like a totem pole, if you will. I said, when I went to Red State, like, to Sundance with Red State, and I was like, I'm buying this movie and taking it on tour, I was holding Wayne Gretzky's last hockey stick he ever used as an Edmonton Oiler. I was like, that's a powerful fucking totem sometimes. You know, it's just an instrument of power you could hold on to and stuff, like the Spear of Destiny. So I said, I'm going to give you, me and Mom are going to give you this totem. Because, you know, from who knows what happens from here on in, but, you know, it's your part of your Patronus, We don't say spirit animal in our house because
come on,
taking from the Native American community and stuff. But I said, this is part of your Patronus and shit. I'll take from J.K. Rowling. She's rich. She's got a lot
rich
of money.
Bitch.
Yeah, totally. She can spare a few. I said, this is your totem. You know what I'm saying? Help you ward off evil, instrument of power and stuff. So before we head up to Sundance and you presumably start your career, we give this to you. And she had no idea. She's like, I'm baffled. And, you know, the whole fucking time, I'm giving this great speech and shit like that. And the kid is, like, so fucking cut from my heart. So she's just like, where's this going? Like, he's just a mystery storyteller. My fucking wife is sitting behind me just like this. Like, fucking hurry up, dude. Totem my ass. Like, fucking. She opens up the thing, dude, pulls that bat out, and goes to fucking pieces, as I knew she would. So I had my camera ready. I was like, ba-bang, 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 ba-bang. And she, I've never seen anyone more fucking happy to receive anything in my life, dude. And it was genuine. Like, oh, she was crying. She cried for the next fucking 2 hours. My office is above her bedroom. And I just kept hearing, and she would text me periodically updates on how emotional she was. This is the greatest thing anyone could ever do for me and stuff. So we left the room, and fuck, I was looking at Jen, and I was like,
look what I did.
Come on.
Who gets a win?
And she just gave me that fucking hard stare, like, and then I headed upstairs. It was fucking awesome, dude. It was sweet. And then she posted the picture, and it got picked up at a bunch of news places. But, you know, a lot of people were like, he bought his daughter that bat. I did not. Warner Brothers sent me the bat, and I gave it to somebody. You know, it's in the family. She's right downstairs and shit, so I ain't going anywhere. But I gave it to somebody who would, as you saw, fucking appreciated the way as if I was like, I've just given you eternal life, you know. It's lovely. All right, enough of my fucking
kid. 4 months from now when she's on, like, the softball team at school. Like,
I'm like, what the fuck?
Don't kill anybody with it, but getting on third, totally fine.
Good night, bam.
Later, bunt.
Staying in the world, all right, fuck all my stuff. Let's get to the fucking world of important news.
Let's blaze.
Staying in the world of Suicide Squad and DC Comics and Warner Brothers and Dawns of Justices and stuff like that. Check out this image, man. Put this up. And let's see if anybody else can find the hidden symbol in this Batman picture.
It's like an episode, it's like an issue of
Empire or something like that?
Yeah.
Should be right there. Should be coming up any second now, that graphic. Which we
it's
can't
coming,
really
dude.
Do anything without it's unless happening. The graphic was up there. We'll kill time until the graphic shows up.
It's like highlights.
Ah,
for kids.
The graphic is there. There it is. Now, that is an image of Batman looking out over what I guess either Metropolis, Gotham, whatever the fuck, as destroyed by Superman. Mm. It's part of the nightmare that he has, where we've seen images from the other trailers
and all that stuff.
Now, I saw that picture and people were like, oh my God. And, you know, I was like, what? I don't get it. Like, I understand he has a dream where shit didn't work out.
Mm.
Go back to the picture. We're not done. Why is that picture significant? Mm. If you look in the mid-ground, Mark.
Yes, middle distance.
Middle distance. You see Batman in the foreground. Well, you see a rock in the foreground. You see Batman kind of in the foreground. In the background, you see the cityscape. But in the mid-ground there,
in the dust.
Drawn into the dust, is a very curious and familiar symbol. Mm. Now we can go to the cartoon version of said symbol and look at that as the picture comes up. Boom! Yo, that is.
Who that?
Fucking Darkseid.
What?
The darkest of dark sides. That's DC's Thanos. Mm. Tell your mom, because your mom knows who Thanos is, but soon she'll know who Darkseid is. It looks like Darkseid, I don't know how Darkseid figures into Bruce's imagination, right. Like he has a dream about the earth getting
like attacked. Suddenly Bruce Wayne is like psychic.
Yeah, and he must know something's out there. I don't know how they're going to explain this shit, but like that's the alpha omega, well, the omega symbol. Like that is the be all end all dark side is. That's fucking
and
dope.
We had talked before about
tell
possibly it being parademons.
We those, thought. And we like, thought it was too good to be true.
Yeah, people were like, that's bullshit. Can't possibly be. And then it was like,
it's for reals. Is for real. What is that? Hold up. Matt's holding up something that says flame pillars.
Do they equal apocalypse?
Do the flame pillars equal apocalypse? Like boom tubes?
Well, go back to the image.
Yeah, throw that image up. Here. Oh, like the fire pits? Yeah. Holy fuck. I didn't even see that, man. There's a lot of information going on in this image, man. And I missed it all.
This is like highlights for kids, but for superheroes.
And you and I are the goofus and gallant of this motherfucker right here. Wow, man. I'm timber toeing around this bitch. We're going to keep the highlights thing going. This is fucking crazy. You're right, man. Those could be fire pits of apocalypse. Boom tubes, man.
Ooh.
Fuck, dude. Fuck. All right, back to us. Fuck. You know what I'm saying? Snyder doing us justice, man. Dawn of Justice.
Why wait?
That's crazy.
For like 8 movies to build a thing when you can build it all in one.
Jam it in. You know what? Snyder's approaching this movie the way everybody approaches sex with an unbelievably hot person outside of their fucking punching weight class. You pull out all the stops, man, to be like, here's this, and I did this once, and fucking this. Every trick in the book, man, because you want them to come back.
We might only get to do this once.
Zack Snyder's directing this movie the way a fat kid gets laid by somebody prettier than themselves. And I speak from fucking experience when I talk about that. Throw it all in, dude.
Yeah.
Whatever works, works. Throw it like spaghetti,
Don't leave anything on the field.
Fuck no, man. Don't leave it in the locker room.
Nope.
Take it straight to the field. Let's talk about The Flash real quick.
Yes.
The Flash, which I go to direct hopefully soon. They've had 2 episodes since we come back from Christmas.
Yes. I'm still behind on one. So don't
did you see the one with Turtle?
Yes.
Loved it.
It was really good.
Shockingly good really for a Turtle good. Episode. And it's, what's his name? It's Chief from fucking Battlestar Galactica.
Aaron Douglas.
Chief Turtle. such a good app, dude. Such, like, they continue to fight. Like, the Turtle's a lame character, and they continue to fucking, like, found a way to make it work. I loved it. I thought it was great. The episode you haven't seen yet, though, as you saw from the tail end of the previous episode, you know who returns. Eobard Thawne.
Yes, Reverse Flash.
Reverse Flash. And he figures prominently in this episode, and it's so good, dude. It's a very emotional ending, too.
I hear that they're starting to finally, not even finally, but start to lead more hints towards who Zoom is.
Yeah, you can tell they're starting to be like, season's wrapping up, we better solve the Zoom
room. We're getting to the end game.
Yeah, but in the meantime, dude, this has been the season with King Shark and fucking Turtle now. And they're crushing it. Like, it totally fucking, God damn it. I can't wait to get up there and ruin the show. I'm going to do such a good job. A lot of people have been like, oh, man, don't fucking go up there and shit like that. And I'm like, I'm going to do their show. I ain't doing my show. I ain't going to be no Bratzies in this fucking thing or anything like that. That's what I do at home. When I'm on somebody else's time, I play by their rules. And I just want to see, look, you think I want to have my name on the worst episode of Flash? Fuck no.
Bad idea.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. I want to have it on one of the best or better or like at least least offensive episodes of The Flash. Whatever. Yeah. I'm going to try to do good, kids.
Top third.
Yeah. 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 See, I ain't aiming for the fucking top. That's let's be honest. Never. But top third,
take it.
It feels pretty good.
Done.
Let's talk movies, man.
Yes.
It's a lot of reboots and sequels going on.
Some of which seem to be a thing people want.
And others?
Some of which seem to be a thing that nobody asked for.
Let's start with the one that I don't know what it would be. But
or why it exists.
But no, I do. I'm shocked it's taken this long to get to it. They're going to redo Masters of the Universe, kids. Look at that. Remember them? All your favorite Filmation heroes. Battle Cat. Orgo. Remember that movie? That's actually a good fucking movie, man.
It's not the worst movie ever made.
No.
Not even the worst Dolph Lundgren movie ever made.
I agree completely. But and Frank Langella is an excellent Skeletor. Let this be our final battle. It's fucking dope. And they took him to Earth. You know what I'm saying? Instead of like, they're all on Eternia. And this, look at this. I mean, I would have felt like, you know, that movie came out, it was what, 15, 16 or something like that? Yeah. Would have been weird if they're all an attorney. You can get away with it now, of course. But, like, fucking that was a smart move where they brought those characters to Earth. Courtney Cox was in it.
Yeah, also because they couldn't afford to actually shoot on a thing that was like Eternia.
So, excellent point.
But what we have is Detroit. So, you guys.
And we'll put you in your funny outfits and you walk around Detroit. It's like Splash with superheroes. They're like, we're not superheroes. So, it's happening. Guess who's going to direct it?
McG.
McG's going to do it, man. Some people are like, I'm a huge fucking Charlie's Angel fan.
Charlie's Angel's fantastic.
Fantastic fucking movie. First one. The second one's okay, but the first one is fucking dynamite, man. So give it to him. He almost did Superman, him with J.J. Abrams' script back in the day.
I mean, yeah. I don't know really who's asking for a Masters Universe movie.
Gotta be somebody. Somebody fucking liked that shit. Like, they sold tons of toys, made a lot of cartoons, and made a movie, so there's gotta be an audience for it.
I guess, but it's us. Ultimately.
And I'm really not that.
Like, they're all like 40, mid-40s dudes who are like, you know what I love? She-Ra. Is She-Ra going to be in this? I don't know.
I feel like in a Game of Thrones and post-Rings world, this is kind of a no-brainer. Like,
ish.
It's just maybe we're not into it. But, I mean, think about it. This might be somebody's first Masters of the Universe, and they'll be like, oh, my God, it's amazing.
Like, you know, that's the same reason they're making a Warcraft movie, is that, you know.
I saw that trailer.
Yeah.
That,
with the Duncan Jones.
Yeah.
That. And like, hey, post-Hobbit, post-Lord of the Rings, like, fuck it, we can do anything, we can do it. There's a huge audience for this. 100 million people play Warcraft on a, you know, daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
I know what the audience is, but I don't really care. Right. I'm not that audience. And if I really wanted that thing, you know, dragons and flying things and orcs, Lord of the Rings is right there.
That's true.
You know, so I don't know. I don't know who Master of the Universe is for. I hope it's good. I hope everything is good.
I guarantee it's for somebody. There's no way this movie doesn't make a fuck ton of money. It's got all the elements, and it's got a big old brand name and stuff. Mm-hmm. And if they just get close and make it just, you know, sci-fi fucked up space fantasy. I'm not even saying make it the new Flash Gordon, although that would be amazing.
100%.
Although that's kind of what the old Masters Universe was, set on Earth and stuff. But I'm all for it, man. I'll pay, you know what? I know me. I'll pay to see it. Because I'll just be like, and I wasn't even a big fucking He-Man fan, man. But I paid to see that other movie because I was just like, oh, yeah, fucking I mean, I 1986 monies, dude. You rented it? I went to the fucking theater.
Wow.
And I was like, I was a bus, was busboy money. I just really could have went to Useful Shit, but I was like, all right, I'll support this because what the fuck? They're making a live-action version?
You know, I didn't even rent it. I worked at a video store, so I just borrowed it.
Son of a bitch.
I stole it.
That was... He is no He-Man, friend to He-Man.
That was piracy in the 80s, is work at a video store and just borrow it and not pay for it.
Piracy in the 80s. That's coming in your future, man. Yes. Battle Cat, Orko. You think they'll do Orko?
They have to.
They got it, right?
I think. He'll be like a junkie.
And then people will be like, are they finally going to have sex, He-Man and She-Ra? And you got to explain. They were brother and sister, you fuck. And they're like, I know.
So?
Are they going to finally have sex? We'll see what happens with that movie. I look forward to it. Skeletor is, I mean, even though I don't watch that cartoon, Skeletor is a fucking cool character.
Kind of badass.
Very badass. All right. Another reboot that's coming.
Yeah. Or sequel or prequel. They haven't really decided or explained.
Really?
Yeah. Labyrinth.
You know more about it. Here, we're going to hear from him. I love this movie, as many people do. It came out.
Ludo Sam. Ludo Sam. Jennifer Connelly.
Look at that and cock. Look Bowie. At the dick on Jarrett the Goblin King.
Bowie's
Goblin is
it.
Dick, man. Holy shit. I saw this movie, 1986, in a movie theater. Got a hand job while it was going on. Then not during the Hoggle scene, I'll tell you
not
that
so
right
much.
Now. And certainly not during the Jennifer Connelly scene.
She's 13 years old.
Yeah, my hand job almost had nothing to do with the movie. It just happened to be in that setting and stuff. But I remember like opening my eyes at one point and seeing him singing, being like, this is the best. I'm getting jerked off while David Bowie's serenading me dressed as a goblin king.
The babe with the power
oh
in
my
pants.
Dance, magic dance. It was... wonderful experience and made that movie so much better for me. You know, some people are like, I don't care for that movie. Well, I fucking love it. But a lot of people online love that movie
totally.
As well. When David Bowie passed away, sadly, a couple weeks ago, naturally, there was a lot of fucking Labyrinth in the air. Mm-hmm. But now, this new story, give him a single because this is important.
Yeah. I mean, Nicole Perlman, I believe, who is the woman who wrote Guardians of the Galaxy, along with James Gunn, is writing this new take. And it's unclear if it's a reboot or if it's a sequel to what we would have seen or if it's a prequel, and we don't know what characters it follows. It clearly can't be following...
It's not going to follow Jareth.
No.
But then, you know, she did away with him in Labyrinth.
Right. So I don't know what the movie is. I feel like the timing of announcing this thing was not quite right.
Right.
Maybe the, you know, 2 days after... Bowie passes away. He's like, hey, it's Labyrinth.
Yeah.
We're pissing on something you loved.
Yeah. You will always be remembered. And we're starting a reboot. You know.
Start the clock.
Jennifer Connelly got to be happy as fuck.
I think so.
Maybe not. Maybe she's like, I got an Oscar, you fat fuck. You think I'm going to go back for the Labyrinth reboot? You're a fucking dick. I heard what they said about your movie on Sunday. Well, shut up, Jennifer Connelly. Yeah, I mean, why not go back? That'd be badass. That would make me want to see the movie.
Right.
If they're like, all right, that movie came out in 86. If it came out this year, it'd be is this the 30th anniversary?
30th anniversary.
How fucking mind-bending would that be if it was about her as an adult and shit? Yeah. And
if it's like the Hook version of Labyrinth.
But way better.
Good.
Yeah. Not like, woo, feet. Oh! A lot of colors and stuff like that. But bright fucking food that you can eat and hurt people with. I don't understand
But
that.
Yeah, the girl who lived goes back to the Labyrinth. I buy
Fuck
that.
Yeah. That'd be amazing. Here we go. They steal her baby. Take that one.
What?
Know what I'm saying?
Shut the fuck up.
I didn't even have to think hard. Just stole the plot from the first.
All of this has happened before.
And will all this happen again. But the only problem is, how do you do it without fucking Bowie?
I don't know.
New guy?
I don't know. It's got to be new guy.
Who would be new person? Who's new person? Like Benedict Cumberbatch.
Right.
Cumberbatch! Who else?
Or maybe you get Jemaine Clement to play David Bowie. we're just doing Bowie.
That's fuck, man. Who...
Can you get Jay Davidson out of retirement?
It's got to be somebody that makes you go, holy fuck. Like, who's one of the most beloved celebrities in the world? I always think of Benedict Cumberbatch.
You know what would be interesting? Sting.
He's not beloved. People make a lot of jokes at his expense. They're always like, he fucking jerks off for hours at a time. It's called tantric.
That's not a joke.
To me, it ain't a fucking joke.
Who are you?
You're only mocking what you don't understand.
He's the Goblin King.
Yeah, he's an idiot for having an 8-hour orgasm. What a dummy.
Sue me.
Remember him as Fade?
Yes.
And Dune? All I
see. I will kill him!
I will. That's awesome. I will kill him! All I see is an Atreides I want to kill.
Who is she, a pet, perhaps?
Can't be him, though. It's gotta be, he's, most people would be like, who's that? Mm. That's Grandpa Sting.
I feel like you might need a musician.
No.
No?
No.
I don't know.
Who's, I mean, as long as it's not a Kardashian, we're fine.
God, you know who they're gonna get? Robert Pattinson.
Nah.
They will. They totally fucking will.
You gotta go somebody, if you were Bowie in Labyrinth, who is the modern day Lady Gaga? And she just won a Golden Globe.
She did, whether she can act or
not. Look how excited Mark is by that idea. High five! all right, man. I mean, again, Lady Gaga's like, fuck you guys, your YouTube show. I got Golden Globe. I could be Jared the Goblin King.
I got a meat dress in the closet that I'm totally going to bring out for this.
Dude, that's if that happens, I just want a little taste. Just a little taste of the box office.
If she's only dressed in food.
Yes, that'd be amazing.
I got a meat dress.
And you get a taste for that.
I got a cheese dress. I got a bread dress. I got a dairy pyramid dress.
And this dress is for when I fall into the bog of eternal stench. Because they got to bring it back. Think about it, dude. You could bring back Ludo. He hasn't aged. He's a fucking puppet. So you just pull him out of the fucking woodwork and you're Ludo fucking back.
And see. We're done, guys.
You can take that too, Nicole. That one right, the Ludo back, is all yours. I'm gonna charge. Another, it's not a remake and it's not a
it's a sequel. Reboot. The thing that
it is a sequel.
Nobody in the world really wants. But
one guy wants fair, and he's gonna make it happen. And I respect this dude for like being his own biggest fan.
He will absolutely like I was in a Fast and Furious movie. 8 of them.
You know who that is. That impression right there. That's Mark's very famous Groot impression. There he is himself.
I want another movie.
Thin Diesel.
Yes.
Except that one shot when he was on the fucking balcony at that hotel. You see, he had a big fucking. I felt good when I saw that. I was like, yeah, man. Fucking. I am Vin Diesel. And then he put a picture up like 2 days later where he's like, bad angle. And he's all cut. I'm like, I ain't Vin Diesel.
Fuck you, Vin Diesel.
Vin Diesel cannot be stopped and will not be stopped, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. And whether you like him or not is irrelevant. What I dig about the dude is he just does whatever the fuck he wants to do. So, yes, just like nobody was asking for a Yoga Hosers movie, nobody's asking for XXX3.
Return of Xander Cage.
But it's fucking happening, dude. It's coming all over your face, neck, and chest.
Yep.
What do we know about it?
Well,
DJ Caruso's directing.
Is he? Did he get Rob Cohen back?
No, he was the guy that did the first
one.
He
did the first
one. Two.
I don't think he did the second one, which starred Ice Cube.
Sam Jackson's coming back. Nina Dobrev from The Vampire Diaries. She used to be on Degrassi. Mm-hmm. She's in the movie. Ruby Rose from Orange is the New Black is a sniper.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Tet snipe.
Is that what it is?
Well, she's very tattooed and she'll be a sniper, so tat snipe.
Production set to start in Toronto. Why not? That most international of locations. Toronto!
Could be anywhere! That looks like Toronto.
And the Philippines. Well, there
well,
you go.
All right. Could be anywhere.
That is kind of exotic. I did not, I mean, I saw the trailer for the first one. What did you, do you ever go deeper than that?
I saw the entire first movie.
And?
It was very much the, we wanted James Bond for like extreme sports.
Right.
So, and the whole thing was like, he's like the extreme sports, he jumps off shit, he skateboards, he does stuff. And the excuse is that he travels the world and can also like fight crime. If it's a thing you like.
I could see, and then so there was one of them.
Yeah, and then
Then he died in the opening of the second one, right?
I think he did. I think it was part of the, like, Vin Diesel is a little too big for this at this point. Like, he had also left the Fast and Furious franchise at the same time. Like, because he walked away.
Right.
At the end of the first one, he's not in Too Fast, Too Furious. He shows up at the end of Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift. And then he shows back up for Fast and Furious, Furious 4, Furious, Furious here.
Makes me scared, like an old man scared, to know that there's this entire mythology that I don't. No. You know what I'm saying? Like, growing up, I knew every movie mythology, even shit I didn't like, you know, or fucking like Masters of the Universe, man. But there's this whole Fast and Furious world that I'm not a car guy, so I never fucking...
Not your jam?
Dove down. And a lot of people are like, you don't have to like cars. I think you would have to like cars to
You
watch
have to
movie.
Be okay with cars to like that movie, but I will say this. Fast Five.
Yeah.
The fifth movie. is like the Avengers of Cars driving movies.
Do you have to see the previous four
Not
for
really.
It to work?
Doesn't matter.
So I could jump in at five.
You could jump in at five. But it works if you've been watching all the other ones, because they start bringing in characters, and hey, there's Tyrese from Too Fast, Too Furious. Hey, there's Han Solo. Literally, there's a character whose name is Han Solo, Asian guy, played by Sung Kang.
Ah!
Han Solo, like the city Solo, yeah. And O-H.
That's pretty genius.
And he's fucking badass. But so they're just assembling the team to do this awesome thing. They add The Rock to be the bad guy, and shit blows up. Great. It's the most amazing homosexual superhero movie you've ever seen. Because
you sold the ticket, dude.
Paul Walker and Vin Diesel in those movies are absolutely in love.
Are they really?
Yeah, there's just like scenes of them like
Triple X in love, like
not quite. But there's lots of like
Fast and Furious.
Lots of them like on a parapet overlooking like the favelas.
Going oh, like, so romantic love.
Yes, absolutely.
Like fucking Harlequin romance book novels, like, not fucking hardcore. Like jam it, you fucker.
Not. I need more pipe. No, it's like. One more job.
It's like Brokeback Love.
It's Brokeback Love before, that's never consummated.
Nice.
You know, and so these movies are just all about them racing from the man and trying to race towards their own love, and they both got girlfriends that they never actually consummate with. And she's like, man, I just love you. One last ride with you, my brother. One last ride.
That's, I mean, isn't that, if you were going to hit on me, wouldn't you be like, one last ride?
One last cast, my man.
There it is.
One last cast.
Holy shit. You sold the ticket in a way that they have never, Universal's never sold me a ticket before. I'm actually going to go home. I'm going to try to convince my wife to watch it with me. I'm like, I hear it's very romantic.
It's 100% romantic, and people get punched a lot. but I have no love for Triple X, so who gives a shit? But somebody does, and Vin Diesel does.
He does, man. And, you know, if he can get it done.
You know, I like a dude who, like, amasses box office power and then does a thing he wants to do with it.
Yeah.
So I can't begrudge him that.
That's true.
At all.
What do you think about a guy who has no box office power, yet still does whatever he wants to do, Mark?
It's a Herculean task, my friend.
Thank you, Mark.
Well done.
In many ways, I am the Vin Diesel of middle-aged, white, independent filmmakers.
Yes, you
me
are.
And David O. Russell, I think.
You guys, you're just chasing the dragon.
Our last stories of the day, Mark.
Yes.
Very important. Thor Ragnarok. Hardcore. Thor. That was a good song. Copyright. Fuck it. Get money.
Not bad.
Theme song. Big question. Does Thor get banished in Ragnarok? To Planet Hulk. For those who know the comic books, Planet Hulk is where Hulk was banished to during what? Civil War or something?
I think it was like the very tail end of like the Illuminati miniseries or something.
Right.
And then who is it? It's like Submariner and Reed Richards and Doctor Strange
Lord
and Tony
Namor
Stark all decide.
Atlantis that is the Prince of the Sea. The forgotten Marvel guy. Nobody ever talks about it no more. Who has him?
Universal, I think, has the rights to name
it. When are they going to dive into the fucking Marvel game?
They've had it forever, and I think...
And they have Hulk. Wasn't Hulk theirs as well?
Hulk was theirs also.
So there must be a deal in place between Universal and Disney already. They still kind of have Hulk. So yeah. If they've kind of got Hulk, and they kind of got Namor, like, I can't believe they're letting DC beat him into the water with Aquaman.
Yeah.
Because Namor is like, that's their Aquaman, for those who are like, duh. Yeah.
And also...
Tell your mom.
Evil Aquaman.
Yeah.
Well, you know,
interesting Aquaman. Right. Like, basically, Aquaman now. Like, they took all the fucking cues of current Aquaman from Namor, where he's like, I'm the Lord of Atlantis. Yeah, I'm not wearing an orange shirt and kissing ass.
Yeah,
Shark in your fucking dick!
I rule 75% of the Earth. Yeah. I want the other 25% too.
I'm way into it. I mean, look, we got Aquaman coming, so that'd be cool, but like... I don't get it. Why aren't they talking to more, man?
Yeah. I mean, I feel like Marvel...
What's going on? Hey, Kevin Feige, come closer.
Scoot closer.
Oh, Scoot.
What are you waiting for?
Come on, dude. He's right there.
Pull Namor out of the water.
Submarine this.
He's getting pruney.
Yeah, for some reason, I want to see a Submariner movie now. You know,
or like, especially because, and I was talking to this about this with our producer, Matt Key, that Marvel doesn't have a massive roster of bad guys. You know,
you're right.
And to this point, the best has been Loki, to the point where they literally just ram him in every movie they can. You know, Ultron was not what we wanted him to be.
And they got rid of him.
Yeah, they got rid of him. Malekith should have been way better than he was, but because they had to split the time between him and Loki, it didn't quite work. But you fucking got Submariner.
Yeah.
Like, why is that not a bad guy you're building towards? I get whatever you're going to do, Thanos, and I know what you're all about with your infinity, blah, blah, blah.
What's more interesting than outer space inner space of the oceans.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Like in outer space, you can, of course, you can make weird creatures. Guardians of the Galaxy, Star Wars have shown us outer space could be amazing. But I'm telling you, man, the future of movies, of sci-fi movies, undersea.
Yep.
Because now you could get, like, somebody's going to nail the we're underwater effect. Mm-hmm. And then it's like the sky's the limit because it's like fucking 96,000 variations of sharks. You know what I'm saying? Every minute he's facing a fucking shark and pulling its jaws apart and shit. And there's another one and another one. And fucking makes the big Crocosaurus and fucking Jurassic World look tiny.
Atlantis Rising, man. That's what I want. Just fucking give it to me. Give it to me.
Meanwhile, but the story is about Thor and Ragnarok. Yes. Looks like Hulk is definitely in, but looks like
Planet Hulk.
Yeah, Hela is played by Cate Blanchett. Cate Blanchett's in this fucker?
Bringing the heat.
I think we knew that already.
We did.
But still.
It's okay, surprise?
Cate Blanchett. I mean, that's fucking huge, man. Hela? What are they called?
Hela.
And that's just a rumor.
So that's a rumor, so it's not necessarily true?
Yeah.
Matt told us it's just a rumor, so don't bank on it. But the rumors, here are the rumors. Ready? As reported by Geek.com. Hela will destroy Mjolnir. She's gonna drop the hammer.
No.
Hammer, don't hit him. And then Hela and Loki banish Thor from Asgard to a gladiatorial planet where you've got to fight and be shirtless. That'd be amazing if they crossed it over and shit like
that.
Thor's gonna fight a lot of guys, just like Mark did. Final boss fight for Thor.
Ooh.
Hulk, you heard it here first. Well, you heard it on geek.com first, man. Hulk recognizes Thor. They both escape together to find a weapon to defeat Hela and his brother Loki. Finding the weapon is the cosmic road trip we've all heard about. So Thor Ragnarok looks like it's shaping up to be...
Fuck it, I'll take it.
You know what I'm saying? It sounds like Ride Along for superheroes. Sounds fun. Good times to be had.
Also starring Kevin Hart.
What is this Guardian? Oh, and this little piece of Guardians of the Galaxy tidbit news, man. My Ego, the sentient planet, might be in Guardians. How could it not be, man?
Because why wouldn't you do that?
Ego, the sentient planet. The living planet, man. Right there.
Okay, I want to know how Ego shaves. I mean, if you're going to give a planet facial hair, then somehow he's got to be able to trim that shit.
Telling you, dude, if you got Ego in a movie, you're one step closer to MODOK. He can pull it off. James Gunn can pull off fucking MODOK and make it make sense. Bill Murray is MODOK. You heard it here first, man. I'm calling
That'd be kind of great.
Okay,
the rumor
so...
is that maybe Pacino... who had been sort of wanting to be in a Marvel movie, wanting to be in a Guardians movie, could be the voice of Ego the Living Planet.
Really?
Yeah.
Look at that.
I mean, fucking also rumor.
More good news. I'll take it. Rumor's better than reality, Mark. Reality's sad. Rumor is hope. And last but not least, Star Wars. We can't talk about Star Wars. They have two pieces of information. One, they revealed this week that I am in Star Wars officially, and I have a voice. I thought I was fucking traitor.
Yeah.
I was hoping I was traitor. Instead, I have a very cool fucking line as a stormtrooper. Where I'm like, we got movement. We got incoming, a 28-6 move. So that's my guy in Star Wars. Sequel to Clerks. That's my guy in Star Wars. If you ever see the movie again, which you will, who the fuck ain't going to watch this from now until the end of time, you can hear me in it. I'm part of the Star Wars universe. Little boy buried what's inside me that I ate many years ago. No, that little kid who loves Star Wars as a kid, he's in fucking the Star Wars universe
totally
right now
is.
As a stormtrooper.
Good for you.
Thank you. Okay, but this is not that news we're going to talk about. That was just... Oh, excuse me, all over the web, and we felt we should say something. Star Wars, Episode 8.
Yes, VIII.
They have moved their date to Christmas.
Yes.
I think we talked about this once on the show. We were like, I bet you they're going to fucking move. Like, why would you, now you own Christmas and see the business you could do, claim the Christmas spot.
So they'd wanted for just nostalgic sake to be the May 25th opening because that's when all the other Star Wars movies had opened.
But you know what they fucking learn? Fuck nostalgia. We got enough in the movie. We don't need no date nostalgia. We sticking with Christmas.
Bullshit.
Christmas. Also, we're replacing that little baby. And that baby is Jesus.
They're also apparently doing some more script work on it.
Is that why they're waiting?
I think what I had heard was,
and
again, this is all rumors and happenstance or whatever, but that they hadn't really taken into account how popular certain characters were going to be post Force Awakens, and now they're trying to sort of rework them in.
Which ones do you think?
My guess is it's Poe. because
apparently the stories were
he was gonna die.
Yeah, like, and JJ talked about that. Yeah. I think I've read an interview where they said like Poe was gonna die in the opening, but they loved Oscar Isaac so much they were like, oh my god, keep him around.
Maybe not dead.
Back. Yeah, yeah. So all right, maybe that makes sense.
So Rian Johnson had written his script based on the initial drafts, the initial plans for episode 7.
No, you better get more Poe in there.
Yeah, we need more Poe.
So. Loop it back. Put in Poe because he made Looper. He fucking Rian Johnson was standing at the end of a fucking empty field with a shotgun.
Blades of gold on his back.
And all of a sudden, fucking what comes through? Some Disney marketing exec going like, we're going to move the movie. He's like,
but I had a plan.
Looper. Either that or there's no gun. He's just standing there with his dick in his hand. Yeah. When the person comes through time, he's like, Gooper. Stole that from Hollywood Babylon. Okay, here's the movements.
Right, because I always like to imagine that the Hollywood release schedule is a bit like Laurence Olivier in Clash of the Titans playing with that little field and just like moving shit and everything else falls down in the real world. What's moving?
What a poetic piece of wordplay that was.
Thank you.
Go to a two-shot.
I'm
fucking
Zeus in that shit.
That's a writer right there, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, they've pushed it from Star Wars Episode 8 from Memorial Day 2017, which is May 26th, for those unfamiliar, to December 15th, 2017, man. And that's a picture of Rogue One. When is that coming out?
This December, I believe.
This December, so yes, 2016. So there's going to be a Star Wars movie every December.
We're going to get one.
Good plan. I like it. Replace Christmas. This is the new Christmas. Remember that movie, Santa Claus, the movie, with Dudley Moore and John Lithgow, and they're trying to make Christmas 2? This is Christmas 2.
I'll take it.
They're finally realizing that crimson dream. The 2017 summer box office, which is coming soon, all over us, man.
Fast and Furious 8 in April.
Fast and Furious in April. Guardians of the this is all the no this is 2017.
2017.
Why are we fucking talking? This is so far away.
I know it is.
I was getting excited.
Sorry, dude.
All right, so not this summer, but next summer. Fast and Furious number 20, whatever. Mm-hmm. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Wonder Woman.
Duh.
There's a Jumanji reboot.
Because.
There's a Mummy reboot.
Starring Tom Cruise.
Really?
Yeah.
Tom Cruise is the mummy hunter or the mummy himself? Is he Imhotep?
He's not Imhotep. I'm pretty sure he's going to be, you know, the white guy who chases them.
He's the guy who runs after Imhotep for like 5 minutes really fast and drives a motorcycle at him and shit. Right on, man. Spider-Man, which is the solo new movie with the little boy, Tom Holland, is that his name or whatever? Mm-hmm. Terminator Genesis.
Not happening.
Oh, no more sequel to that?
Yeah, they very quietly yanked that from the release schedule.
That's been replaced by Baywatch, May 19th.
The Rock.
And Star Wars Episode 8 goes to Christmas, which already has, well, 12/15, which already has Spielberg's Ready Player One is opening on 12/15/17.
So who blinks?
Oh. Well.
Spielberg blinks.
You think?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He has to.
At box office analyst Jeff Bock. The Bock office master himself, he said this.
Ooh,
you're ready for his quote. Me. 2017 as a whole will undoubtedly destroy all box office records.
Wow.
I don't know if I'm really based on these movies.
I don't know. But also,
Mark Bernardin doesn't agree with you, Bock.
Yeah, I mean, it could. Could not. Who gives a shit? But
now that's news reporting right there. Could, could not. Who gives a shit? I could pay it either way.
Avatar 2 was supposed to open, theoretically, in winter of 2017.
What happened, Jim Cameron?
Jim Cameron, well, I mean, Fox kind of hoped it would be a thing that happened, but he hasn't shot a stitch of video frame or anything yet.
He hasn't shot any of Avatar 2 yet?
No. Unless he's stuck in a performance volume somewhere that nobody's
heard of. That is an impressive filmmaker. Indeed. But like, a sequel's coming in a year, he's like, I know.
Yeah.
Are you going to shoot anything? He's like, don't worry about it.
We'll get there.
Yeah.
But he also...
I made a boat sink. And break in half. And then I took you to the island of blue cats in space. Fuck you. I got this. So
Fox was totally fine with moving Avatar 2 off of the December date in 2017. It was supposed to be like, yeah, no problem. We can push it.
Yeah, they're like, we ain't going up against that juggernaut.
Yeah. And I think Disney also moved up Pirates 5 by a couple
of months. So it's going to happen a little earlier.
A little earlier.
All these big movies coming all over your face, neck, and chest, man. Somewhere in there in the nooks and crannies, Yoga Hosers.
Yeah.
We'll let you know. What a big week. What a lot of information.
We crammed it, dude.
We did. We crammed it, man. We end the very big week with a very big news report. And welcome you back to some full-time Fat Man on Batman action. How'd you like that fucking show with fucking Castle and fucking Tudyk.
Jesus.
How about that? Castle and Tudyk is a spinoff that's coming soon.
Simon and Simon, Castle and Tudyk.
More of that, right? I saw a lot of people going, do more of this shit. So yeah. We'll get more guests in the Why future not? And stuff.
But especially if they're TV stars.
That helps. But cool. We do honestly like talking to each other. So
yeah. A little bit of that, a lot more of this.
A lot more of this. Way more of this.
Everybody wins.
There it is, folks. All the news. This was the fucking news. Now it's over for this week, man. Thanks for hanging out. We'll see you here in the Fat Cave, man. For Fat Man on Batman, I'm Kevin Smith.
Mark Bernard.
Tune in next week. Same fat time, same fat channel.
YouTube.com/Kevin Smith.
Hey man, it's me, Kevin Smith. Thanks for watching. Do me a favor, click that thing below that says subscribe. Every time you click that, you save a baby kitten from murder.